Welcome to another discussion about the origin of the Carolina Bays and other elliptical basins oriented toward the Great Lakes. This presentation examines the basins in Kansas, which produce some surprising results that may change the story of the Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis. It is well known that Nebraska has elliptical basins like the Carolina Bays, but this is also true of Kansas. The terrain in Kansas is rough and it has been subjected to a lot of erosion, so it is difficult to see the elliptical basins even with LIDAR. This image highlights some of the elliptical basins in Kansas between the cities of McPherson and Hutchinson. A paper published in 2009 by Richard Firestone makes a case for the Younger Dryas extraterrestrial impact event that resulted in the extinction of the North American megafauna and the Clovis people 12,900 years ago. The paper illustrates the convergence by the Great Lakes of the Carolina Bays, Nebraska basins, and other elliptical basins like the ones in Kansas. The Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis, published in 2017, proposes that the basins originated from secondary impacts of glacier ice ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. I will examine several basins in Kansas that have not been too badly eroded so that they can be fitted with ellipses by the least squares method. The inset of this image shows the location of a basin 5 kilometers north of McPherson, Kansas. The east and west portions of the basin rim have been washed away by a creek that runs through the middle of the basin, but enough points can be selected on the north and south part of the rim to fit an ellipse. The ellipse has a length of 1,671 meters, which is just over 1 mile. The eastern part of this basin has been completely washed out by a confluence of several streams, and the rim does not have a smooth shape. It is difficult to select points along the perimeter of the basin when the rim has been badly eroded. The colorized topography provides some clues to determine the transition between the flat portion of the basin and the rim. Some of these points are educated guesses, and they will affect the size and orientation of the ellipse. This basin has a length of 2,600 meters and an azimuth of 254 degrees. This is the Kansas Basin illustrated in the 2009 paper by Firestone. The colorized topography and the 20x vertical exaggeration of the Cintos LIDAR show additional features that are not apparent in the LIDAR image from Firestone. This elliptical basin is enormous. It has a length of 9,423 meters or 5.8 miles. The ellipse has an azimuth of 259.5 degrees. The ice projectile that made this large basin would have had the diameter of 1.9 kilometers and kinetic energy equivalent to 5,900 megatons of TNT. This large basin has another basin within it. There are many examples of basins within basins on the East Coast. This is an indication of multiple impacts at the same location with different ballistic trajectories. Impacts within previous impact cavities are also seen in experiments. The small impact crater on the side of the large impact crater in this example was buried during viscous relaxation. Using ballistic equations, we can calculate that the creation of the Carolina Bays and the Kansas Basins occurred within 6 to 9 minutes after the extraterrestrial impact. The process of viscous relaxation to create a relatively flat surface in a large basin must take less than 4 minutes in order for a second impact at the same location to create a crater that is not obliterated by viscous relaxation of the large cavity. This large basin is adjacent to two small overlapping basins. As in a previous example, the east and west portions of the rim have been eroded by a stream that crosses the basin. The points selected along the north and south margins of the basin can be fitted with an ellipse, and all the points fall along the path of the ellipse. The basin has a length of 2,967 meters, which is 1.8 miles. Notice that the azimuth of the basin is 266.8 degrees, which is very close to an east-west orientation. The north side of this basin has some man-made terraces for erosion control that have destroyed the rim. There are also four breaks in the rim from water drainage. I selected points along the perimeter of the basin, avoiding the breaks in the rim and the man-made terraces. This basin has a length of 2,093 meters. A satellite image of the same area shows that LIDAR is indispensable for the study of the impact basins. Without LIDAR, we would not even know that there is a mile-long basin at this location. This image shows two elliptical basins 15 kilometers west of Wichita, Kansas. The northwest portion of this basin is completely eroded. We can only select points along the east and south portions of the basin where the rim is well defined. The basin has a length of 1,146 meters. The second basin west of Wichita is highly eroded. The basin can probably be fitted with an ellipse, but the rims are very degraded in a large part of the basin, and it is not possible to select points on the rim with confidence. This is one basin that we have to skip. Approximately 5 kilometers south of Spearville, Kansas, there is another elliptical basin. We select points along the perimeter where the green color of the center of the basin transitions to yellow. This basin has a length of 2,806 meters, and it is oriented more toward the north than the other basins that we have examined. About 10 kilometers southeast of Kinsley, Kansas, there is a basin with a well-defined southern rim. The transition of the yellow to orange colors in the colorized topography makes it possible to outline the basin. The length of this basin is 2,507 kilometers, and its azimuth is 262.2 degrees. But wait! Shouldn't this basin be smaller? Should the sandbar indicated by the arrow be the northern rim of the basin? Using the sandbar as the northern rim of the basin provides an ellipse, but the points to the west are mostly guesses because there is no well-defined rim. In general, an ambiguous situation should be recognized and should not be used as the basis for any conclusions. There are some structures near Mineola, Kansas that may be elliptical basins, but they are very degraded. Only one of them seems to have a well-defined rim that is suitable to be fitted with an ellipse by the least squares method. This image shows great circle trajectories for the azimuths of the Kansas basins that were fitted with ellipses. The orientation suggests that the ice boulders that made these basins originated from Lake Erie. This is a surprising result, and there are several problems. The first problem is that the Nebraska basins and the Carolina basins converge by Lake Michigan. If the orientations of the Kansas basins are correct, then we have to conclude that there must have been at least two extraterrestrial impacts, one by Lake Michigan and another one by Lake Erie. The second problem is the lack of ice on Lake Erie 12,900 years ago at the Younger Dryas boundary, which is the preferred time for a catastrophe because at that time there is a platinum anomaly attributed to an extraterrestrial impact. This is also the time of the onset of a global cooling event, a megafaunal extinction, and the deposition of a black mat that marks the extinction event. Geologists would not object to the glacier ice impact hypothesis on the basis of lack of ice if the Carolina Basin and other impact structures had been created by extraterrestrial impacts 16,200 years ago, because at that time, both Lake Michigan and Lake Erie were covered with ice during the Port Bruce advance. However, the energy of the ballistic sedimentation of the ice boulders that made the elliptical basins was equivalent to 8 megatons of TNT per square kilometer in some areas. This was enough energy to trigger an extinction event, and this is why it is desirable to associate the emplacement of the Carolina base with the extinction. This brings up the question, how do geologists determine the ice sheet coverage at a site that was hit by a comet or asteroid? One would expect that a 2 kilometer thick ice sheet would prevent the impact from forming a typical crater and that the ice pieces would just scatter without leaving any moraines at the impact site. These elliptical basins still have many mysteries. The Carolina Bays should not be neglected. Ask your geology professors to discuss the Carolina Bays because they are the most prevalent geological structures in the Atlantic coastal plain. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.